What profession was once highly respected, but is now a complete joke? My dad used to have, can operate MLs on his CV in the 90s. ML operator. Ah, yeah. How times have changed. Now it's can operate tweets. Great point. I honestly don't think I could run the social media of the place I work at. Running business social media is exhausting and thankless. My girlfriend is in marketing, most of it digital, and she runs all the social media for a company. Imagine you have to create posts and articles for your company that have to sound good and are attention grabbing every time, and you post several times a day. It's harder than it sounds. It's not like a personal account where you can just say whatever and it doesn't matter. Even Marizo for her, because she markets for a real estate investment company, so it has to sound good, be interesting, but also serious for her target audience. Lace makers. Used to be a very skilled profession that took years to learn and over a decade to master. But, because it was so labor intensive, lace was sold at very high prices. Now, it probably only takes a few months to get comfortable with the machines that make it. And of course, the laborers are Chinese sweatshop workers. It's interesting how technology alters our perception of the value and beauty of something. My grandparents thought lace was the classiest thing and I always thought it was tacky. Similarly with aspic and gelatin based foods, went from special occasion fancy rich people's food, to a novel treat, to meh, in a generation. Lobster. 2. People used to have clauses in their contracts saying they would not have it more than twice a week. It was a poor man's food, used for fertilizer. I had some clause in my contract once. Webmaster. I used to be a webmaster at a huge company. Then I became the internet manager. I set it free, giving people their own responsibility within guidelines. A new organization grew up out of it, much looser and freer than before, encompassing social networks and video. But there were still gatekeepers and checks to make sure you were doing things without taking risks or breaking any laws on privacy or copyright. And all was well. Then one day, because I was now in charge of the corporate communications web presence, I had to go through my own process to relaunch a mobile application which had got quite clunky. So I had a certifiable, fully paid up member of the young people challenging me and explaining very slowly what mobile was. And did our department have a real need for this? I was so proud of what I had spawned. The answer was yes, but there were a few tense moments as he made sure I was aware there were two main mobile platforms. A few years later I took early retirement and now sit near the bus station most days with a jug of red, telling anyone who will listen, and many who will not, that I pioneered blink tags back in the day, and you can't believe how difficult coding was before they introduced CSS. Is this pasta? Milkman. Feels bad, man. Hey. My husband is a milkman. And my kids look like him too. So do all your neighbors' kids. Someone who describes themselves as an entrepreneur. When I was in business school, we had an entrepreneurship class where we had guest speakers, and it very quickly dawned on everyone in the class that entrepreneurship presenter meant either one of two things. 1. A gray-haired, jovial old man who has started and sold at least a dozen businesses in his life, and will readily admit that times have changed and that owning a successful business is as much about luck as it is about hard work. 2. A greasy 30-something who looks like Joel Osteen and can turn out more tech buzzwords per second than a Forbes editorial. He looks like he just ripped a fat line of coke off the classroom number sign on the way into the presentation, and has this almost cult why anything is possible if you work hard enough spiel he gives at least 4 times in the presentation, reworded each time. I'm not talking run-of-the-mill pay attention to what the customer wants and focus on changing trends stuff. I'm talking about that used car salesman meets Wolf of Wall Street every day. I get up at 4:30 in the morning. The sun comes up over the horizon and you know what it says? It says Juan, let's get this bread. Oops. Whenever they describe their work day, it's always wake up at 4:30 to 5:30. Go for a run / gym. Breakfast. 2 hours of solid emails. Meditate. 1 hour scheduled social media read self-help book / listen to podcast. Speech to staff. End the day early and spend time with my family because they are most important. So where in all of that do you develop and run your business? Is it the emails? What does that even mean? So I ran a small engine repair business for a while, have a few self-storage businesses, some ATMs, some rental properties, and a weed farm. Each one of these works differently in how I run it schedule-wise. For instance, small engine repair? That was about 4 hours advertising a week and the rest working in the garage slash phone call slash picking up and delivering it. Self-storage? Literally just interview the 2 employees I have at a given place and some MLs are the only major things. ATMs? ML small businesses. Ask if I can set one up, then spend one day every other week refilling them. I assume the cost of entry into self-storage isn't super cheap, but it seems like a relatively simple and stress-free way to make money. Is that the case? And does it generate income well? How do you go about purchasing an ATM to put into a store? Are there a ton of financial regulations etc. that make it a huge pain? I assume the big risk is theft of the machine. Is the risk all on you, or does the store have any liability? Are there expensive insurance payments for that risk? It's been 6 hours. He's trapped in a unit. A therapist, a life coach slash diet coach, etc. I'm not talking about educated, licensed therapists with legit degrees. I'm talking about this massive amount of people on social media advertising themselves as quasi therapists. As a person with an actual master's degree in social work, nothing infuriates me more than sumps with an online life coaching certification, acting as if our levels of experience in and know-how are comparable. They are not. But have you tried these essential oils? I feel like essential oils get a bad rap because of how so many people use them. I've got a bunch of different essential oils, and you know what I use them for. Making stuff smell nice. Are they therapeutic? Kind of. Nice smells are relaxing and put people in a good mood. Is there any actual medical use for them? Absolutely not. But when some weird religious lady tells me that they will cure vaccine-caused autism, I'm gonna go smell some lavender eeps and calm myself ups down after hearing that nonsense. The biggest problem is the word essential, implying that they're important when the definition being used in that terminology is essence of which is completely different. Teachers. For much of history, they were seen as wise, enlightening people. Now, they're often packaged into a rigid system and paid barely anything. Depends in which country you teach. My wife is a primary school teacher in the Swiss public system. They are respected and get pretty well paid, and unless she peeps up real badly, she has a job for life. In Germany too. Just not respected. They get the hate of everyone. This. I'm a teacher in Berlin. The pay is good, but holy peeps, is there no appreciation for the work. Recently the state and federal government decided it might be a good idea to provide work laptops to teachers. We use our own devices for work. I briefly looked at the reaction in the comment sections and on Twitter. Holy peeps, I should not have done that. Honestly, this is something that infuriates me to no end. I'll keep my opinions about our education system as a whole out of this, otherwise this would be a long rant. Despite that, I just can't understand the lack of respect and appreciation for our teachers. Education is one of the most important things in society. Without proper education, neither the society nor the country will prosper. So why do so many people refuse to give teachers the appreciation, respect and honestly also pay they deserve when they handle most of the education of our children and oftentimes heavily influence the paths our children take later on? A secretary. If I'm remembering correctly, historically it was extremely respected until keyboards became more mainstream. Women started taking the job more often happened, and it becoming more common in the workplace. A good admin is worth their weight in gold. They can make a department slash manager's life great or horrible. Agreed. I once worked with a long-time admin who knew everything about the higher-ups, their personalities and tastes. She helped tremendously in critical meetings between our department, executives, and clients. For interdepartmental relationships, she knew who we should partner up with and who would stab us in the back. They are your eyes and ears into the rest of the organization and are worth treating well and paying for. I still keep in touch with her today, even though we don't work for the same company anymore. Groom of the stool. The what now? Not sure when this practice ended, but I know the Henry VII had one. This guy's job was to help Henry take a dump. Then he checked the turds out to see if Henry was healthy. No, we are not making this up. I hate that. In its day, groom of the stool was a very prestigious job. I'd imagine being groom of the stool then would be comparable to president's primary physician today. You are the man or woman in the modern case, entrusted with the health, if the most powerful single individual in the kingdom slash country. And because you are with the king so much, you are then sought out by people who would like you to put in a good word on their behalf. Congress right now, honestly. Nobody likes Congress as in the abstract idea of the whole governing body, but very few people actually vote against their own congressional rep in the general or primary election. My idiot isn't the problem. All the other idiots are the problem. My name's Ben Wyatt, and I approve this message. Exorcist. Still a badass job title though.